in the Word of God and bring you this thought. Luke chapter 5, we're going to look at the little parable here that the Lord said about putting new wine in old bottles and vice versa. And he said in verse 36, and he spake also a parable unto them. No man putteth a piece of new garment upon an old. If otherwise, then the new maketh a rent, and the piece that was taken out of the new agreeth not with the old. And no man putteth new wine into old bottles, else the new wine will burst the bottles and be spilled, and the bottles shall perish. But new wine must be put into new bottles, and both are preserved. No man having drunk old wine straightway desireth new, for he saith, the old is better. And I want to preach on those last four words of that verse. The old is better. Tonight, I'm going to talk about how we got in the mess we're in a little bit. And I'm going to talk about three things that are new in our world and how the old is better. I don't think something's wicked or evil or of the devil just because it's new. I'm not against everything that's new. I don't want to go back to horse and buggy days. I like having a car. I like air conditioning. I'm okay with Walmart and Golden Corral and cell phones and medical and scientific advancements. That's wonderful. Thank the Lord for it. Technological advances for help and health and stuff like that and people's health is good. But the way the world is going tonight, and the new this, the new that, basically three things, I'm saying to you, the old is better. Now, I will talk about three things tonight: the new morality, the new age movement, and the new world order. And say to you tonight, the old is better. I will talk first of all tonight about the new morality. Now, back in the day, and I won't take time to get into all that tonight, it could be a whole sermon, things were different than they are. And basically, in this country is what I'll be talking about. The new morality that they talk about is really the old immorality. That's all it is. But back in years ago, there was a home. Our society was founded and built and established on the home. A mom, a dad, children. That family, well, it was a godly home and went to church. Everything those kids heard at home was reinforced at church and vice versa. Everything they heard at church was reinforced in the home. Those kids went to school, and when they went to school, it was semi-enforced at school. Back in the old days, you remember the Little House on Prairie? You remember the Little Rascals? We went, you know, up there, we seen one the other day, an old school, old replica of an old school building where the little benches are, and the kids sit on the little benches, had a little desk, and up on the blackboard, it had the verse for today. And it had a verse, do unto others as you'd have them do unto you, and different Bible verses. And our entire school system and our entire judicial system was built upon the Bible. That Bible right there, the King James Bible. And brother, the United States was not perfect. All them old folks, they wasn't perfect. Of course they wasn't. But I'm telling you, society was way different back then. I'm talking about in the 30s, in the 40s, and in the 50s. About the late 50s, things began to change. As some old preacher said the other day, he said, Lord, when they was growing up, the worst thing they ever seen at the movies was when Roy Rogers kissed his horse. And they didn't see anything any worse than that. Think about what kids see now in the new morality. They had things basically in biblical order. And whether people were Christians or not, our society was built upon what they called Judeo-Christian values. In other words, the Ten Commandments, thou shalt not kill, thou shalt not steal. Our law system, everything, court system is built upon those commandments of God in His Word. But things begin to change. I remember as just a little kid when things changed. I remember feeling it. I remember feeling the Spirit of God when I was little. My mom and my two aunts, Aunt Shirley and my Aunt Bee, would sing at the house. We'd go over to their house. My Aunt Shirley had a piano, or so, one of them did. We'd go over to their house, they'd have a piano, and my Aunt Shirley would play the piano, and they would sing. And us kids, we'd just run through the house. We'd about this high, and I remember just running back and forth through the house. And when I would run through the house, I would hear it. I would hear them singing, "Where will I shelter my sheep tonight? I'll shelter my sheep at God's door." I had no idea in the world. I said, "Mom ain't got no sheep. What's she talking about?" I didn't know what in the world they were singing about. But I knew it was something to do with God, and that there's a God. But I remember singing, "Lord, oh Lord, oh Lord, I want to go to heaven. Hell is an awful, awful place." I mean, I was 8 and 9 and 10 years old. I remember Mom taking us to revival, and my mom would get up and sing, and my aunt, I was just a little boy about that high, and I remember wallowing around in the pew. They didn't have padded pews. They just wood pews, and I'd lay there, you know, and your breath would hit the back of that pew, you know, and everything. And I remember that old preacher, he'd come down the aisle, and buddy, he'd slap him, man, get red in the face, and I remember thinking, there is a God. There is a God. I remember thinking that. I didn't understand it, but I remember thinking there was a God. And I grew up like that, and basically, when we went to school, if you told a lie, you got in trouble. If you took something that wasn't yours, you got in trouble. That was the old morality. And I'll never forget when things begin to change. And I will never forget. I remember it just as plain as I'm standing here. My older sisters, my sister Sandy, she danced. She watched American Bandstand every Saturday. That's when the American Bandstand came on. And my sister was doing the floor, and she'd do all the best twist again. Like it is. I saw, shut up. I ain't got no hips. And ain't supposed to have and won't have, God willing. Amen. I remember Sandy and everything, and she knew every dance. She did the jerk. We played Louie. I wanted to play the music. I didn't want to dance. And we started playing the band, and the Beatles came. And when the Beatles came, things began to change. Things, they brought something with them. I personally believe the devil was looking for a way in, like bugs look for a way in and leave a door open. And the Beatles opened the door. That's my opinion. And there's other ways that come in, up from down in South America, up through New Orleans and jazz, and the beginning of rock and roll in 1955, back in those days. And when the Beatles came, everybody went crazy over the Beatles. And when the Beatles first came, they go, "Dun, dun, 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 dun." You know, and that was their song. And they wasn't good songs, but they were not satanic. You know what I'm saying? They were just fleshly and everything. And I loved it. Everybody went crazy. And about halfway through the Beatles' career, they went over to India or somewhere, and they met the guru Mataraji Jishi Manushu, somebody like that. And this weird dude was hooked up with demons up to his ears, and he had a big long beard over there, and he was going like this, you know what I mean? Put that spot on there. And when they came back to America, they introduced right then Eastern mysticism into American culture. Now, I'm telling you, I remember plain as day going to a dance at Nebo High School over there, and we went had a high school dance, and I wasn't saved, but I felt the Spirit of God when I was young. And I remember going to that dance that night, and there was these hippies. I'd never seen a real hippie in real life. They had just come out and started coming into Marion. People started getting drugs. I remember hearing about people smoking pot. I remember hearing people about doing LSD, and that was what was popular back then, and they called it something else like methadone now, but it was called something else then, and THC and a bunch of stuff like that. And I remember this girl got out there, and she had on old long nasty looking blue jeans down to here, and she had this hippie hair, no makeup, nothing, just hippie. And she was doing like this, you know, and I remember thinking, this is getting weird. I remember thinking, I like the music, but I remember thinking, something ain't right here. I remember things changing. And then about that time, the fifth dimension come out with a song, and all of them said, "When the moon is in the seventh power and Jupiter aligns with Mars." And I thought, what in the world are they saying? "And peace aligns the planets, and da da da. This is the dawning of of the, have you ever heard that song? Raise your hand. Age of Aquarius. And what they were saying was that the planets are lined up right and we're bringing a new age and a new morality. And they called it the new morality. And all of a sudden, sex, drugs, and rock and roll took over this country. Everything changed. They voted God and the Bible out of our school system. They said, no more. We're going to be a global, inclusive society. We're not going to offend anybody. Everything began to change. And brother, I'm telling you tonight, I never, ever, ever will forget. Things began to change. Men's hair got long. Men turned into women. Women turned into men. Blurred the line between the sexes. And the new morality took over this country. And it just about destroyed us tonight. I'm telling you, the old is better when it comes to morality. Say amen right there. Lord have mercy. When you went to church, brother, you'd go to church and you'd preach or preach, and they'd preach conviction. When you went to church, they'd preach on sin. When you went to church, they'd preach on hell. When you went to preach, they'd preach on the judgment day. They preach and preach. Something's gone wrong in this country tonight. This gender blender, transgender, everybody's nothing, there's no such thing as male and female, is of the devil. I don't know, somebody sent me a video, somebody from Nebraska or somewhere sent me a video, Idaho or somewhere, and sent me a video, said, watch this, pastor, and it's got the newest style for men this summer. You know what they're doing? You know what they're doing, men? All you boys, listen to me, young men. They're trying to make a girl out of you. They're trying to make you real feminine acting. And they're trying, they think that male masculinity is the evil enemy of society and that we should bring down masculinity and make boys real just soft. And the clothing now ain't going to say boys and girls. It's just for young humans, whatever they call them. And now, are you ready for this? The clothing this summer for men is romper suits. Really, honest to goodness, under the Lord, you know, I didn't even know what a romper suit was. It's these little things that boys, you put on babies, and they come right here, and they're just one piece and little shorts right here. And it shows these grown men in romper suits. I'm telling you, if you men start showing up in romper suits, we're going to have a talk around here. Now, enough's enough, bless God. Amen. I tell Brother Derek you want him up here in a romper suit. Lord, I'm telling you, brother, it'll be snowing you know where. A bunch of old redneck guys are wearing a romper suit. That's a new morality. Look, it's unbelievable. It's all grown men, muscles, with a romper suit. Lord, have mercy. I'm telling you, Kelly sent me a little thing on my phone. This little kid, he's 11 years old. 10 or 11 years old, little boy. Dressed up like a girl, tons of makeup on, and saying, my mama, he's trying to get in Hollywood. They're making perverts out of you. They're saying now that, you know, when a girl goes to the doctor when she's expecting a baby, like Miss Gino over here, and she's expecting a baby, and they go to the doctor to find out if it's a boy or a girl, they say, no, 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 you shouldn't tell them it's going to be a boy because you don't know. Now, if biologically it could be born with male parts, but it really might not be a male. You shouldn't determine that. Let that child determine what it is. Listen, people, we've gone crazy. That's mental insanity. That ain't morality. That's the old immorality. Brother, I remember when preachers used to stomp their feet. There's something wrong with this new generation of preachers. Don't tell me, old Danny, you're stuck in the old days. I'm stuck in the Bible. What's wrong with that? Hey, I'd hate to be in touch with the generation me and you live in. God have mercy on a preacher that gets along with this generation that we're living in right now. We ain't supposed to. You're backsliding. backslid if you get along with the generation we're living. Lord, I'm about ready to haul off here and preach a little while tonight. But I'm telling you one thing, brother. Right's still right. Wrong's still wrong. Boys still boys. Girls are still girls. There's supposed to be a difference in the way we act. Supposed to be a difference in the way we think. God made us that way. Stay that way. Amen right there. I'm telling you tonight, the new morality is of the devil. Look how Billy Sunday preached. Look how J. Frank Norris preached. You know what they did? J. Frank Norris, the district attorney, pastored the First Baptist Church in Dallas-Fort Worth, Texas. He pastored the two largest churches in America at the same time. Temple Baptist in Detroit and First Baptist of Fort Worth. You talk about a man, that was when men were men. And J. Frank Norris got on there, and Buddy, that old boy preached, and the district attorney and them tried to shut him down. They had a lynch mob downtown for him one day, and he said, you come down here, we're going to hang you. They had a literal rope with a noose and everything that's going to hang Norris on the courthouse yard down in downtown. He found out about it. They said, preacher, you better what? They're down there. He said, where are they at? Tell me. He went down there and walked right in the middle of that crowd, wound up preaching right in the middle of it. They wound up singing in the sweet by and by, had a bunch of people, had 300 people saved, and had a revival started in that place right there. That was when men were men. He didn't sit up and say, let's all get along. We just all need to get along. Everybody love each other. Oh, we have our differences. Lord, he'd have threw up if he'd acted like that. They would have hung him if he'd acted like that. Peter Cartwright, the great preacher, Sam Jones, all those old, Billy Sunday used to break chairs on the platform, wound up preaching in his T-shirt, have his sleeves rolled up, broke chairs. J. Frank Norris, one time, the district attorney said he was going to put him out of business. Norris preached about it. He tried every bit of thing in the world to stop him, and a train hit him down downtown and killed him. One of the men went down there and scraped that man's brains up off the train track, put it in a jar, and put it on the pulpit. Sunday night, Norris preached on, thou art weighed in the balances and are found wanting. How would that go over nowadays? That's how different things was just 50 years ago, people. I say we are a bunch of sissies. Where's the men? I mean, if you're a man, you ought to be glad you're a man. Thank God you're a man and be a man. If you're a woman, you ought to thank God you're a woman. Praise God as a woman. Be the best woman you can be proud of and don't be jealous of a man. It's a new morality. Lord have mercy, I'm stirring them up tonight, ain't I? Amen. I'll tell you a little bit about the church nowadays. Oh, for all you people that's going to hear this on radio and internet, if you go to a church that's doing these things, you are in a messed up church. Number one, the Scripture alone is not the final authority. The Scripture alone is not the final authority. An experience is. A vision is. A dream is. Some fool thing like that. Martin Luther and them guys said, when they with the Reformation, they come to Martin Luther one time, them guys, and they said, but the church fathers say, and he said, the Bible said, but the church fathers say, and the Bible, and Martin Luther looked back at him and said, the blazes were the church fathers. What saith the Scripture? Amen. And that's my position tonight. What saith the Scriptures? Number two, a new method of growth other than the preaching of the gospel. Buildings, namely. You get a nice enough building, a nice enough fellowship area, and a nice enough there, you can get a crowd coming here. Jethro Bodine. Number three, little or no preaching on sin, the second coming of Christ, or hellfire. When a church don't preach on sin, the second coming of Christ, and hellfire, you've done fell into a modernistic, liberal, compromising, mega mess. Number four, A literal millennial reign is rejected and considered unbiblical. That's where all this kingdom preaching comes from. The kingdom preaching. And we're in the kingdom. We're in the kingdom. Them nuts think we're in the kingdom now, and we are spiritually reigning with Christ right now. You know the devil's bound during that time, don't you? Lord, have mercy if he's bound now. Like that old preacher said one time, he said, is the devil bound now? He sure do have a long chain. The old preacher said, if the devil's bound now, he's bound to my coattail. I said, I meet him everywhere I go. The devil ain't bound now, but he will be then. Number five, you know you're in a false church when they teach replacement theology. That means they take all the promises that God made to Israel and apply them to church spiritually to me and you. That's false doctrine. That's heresy. Number six, they believe that the book of Revelation is in the past and not future and already fulfilled, or else it's allegorical. That's where you know you're in a false church. Like the mark of the beast really ain't a real mark, and it really ain't 666, and hell don't really mean hell, and judgment don't really mean, you know. Don't take it literally. Number seven, they experiment with a mystical form of Christianity to reach a postmodern society or generation. Number eight, they believe and teach, like Brian McLaren, that Christianity needs to be reinvented to reach this generation. We need to reinvent Christianity to relate to the world in the year 2017. No, we don't. We don't change the Bible to fit the generation. If anybody gonna do the changing, it's gonna be them. You say, but we're not reaching them. We're not called to reach them. We're called to be faithful and preach to them and do our best. According to that theology, Noah was wrong. He didn't reach them. He didn't reach none of them. But his family. None of them. But his family. Number nine, the pastor's continually speaking of ancient or vintage Christianity. We need to go back and see what made the early church effective and then learn how we can relate to this day and time. No. So that people might embrace, that's the word nowadays, embrace Christianity. We always thought it meant get saved. You don't embrace Christianity. The Lord embraces you, brother, and the Holy Ghost convicts you and borns you and births you into the family of God. Next, the authority of the Bible is undermined by images and sensual experiences, and as promoted as a way to know God. Number 11, icons, candles, liturgies, labyrinths, and contemplative prayer is substituted for real prayer. Anybody know what contemplative prayer is? It's saying the same thing over and over and over again. Hallelujah, 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 until you kick your brain in neutral. That's a dangerous shape to get in. Jesus said, use not vain repetitions. There ain't nothing wrong praying the same prayer a million times if it's coming from your heart. But empty, vain repetition will get you nowhere. Number 12, there's a strong emphasis on ecumenism. In other words, we're going back to Rome. To a one-world religion. Number 13, re-examining the church fathers and suggesting they went too far. Number 14, suggest there's many ways to God, like that unscriptural Shack book teaches. That's heresy. It's against the Bible. Number 15, the pastor has to sort of push aside those who resist changes, cutting out the Sunday school, bringing in the band, putting blue lights, flashing smoke coming up out. You got a lot of people saying, no, we don't like this. And anybody over 50, your opinion don't count. We want the 30-year-old soccer moms that's been to college and their mom, daddy got a lot of money. You better watch that outfit. Number 16, rock and roll music, brother, is a sure sign your church done fell off edge. I'm set. You can get mad at me. You can disagree. You can say everybody got their own opinion. I'm telling you, rock music has no place in the house of God. It's a devil's music. Ain't got no place in your stereo for that matter. If you want the honest truth about it. Well, I talked about the new morality. And I guess I'm going to have to break it off here and we'll continue a little bit later. I was going to talk about the New Age movement and the one world government. What I'm going to do, I'm going to break it up into two parts and do it next time. I wonder tonight, look at here, I've got quotes of pages. How that are the global elite. Now we're closer to a one world government than we've ever been before. A series of interlocking treaties that the past administration signed. I'm not politicking, I'm just saying, stating a fact. That done got us into a mess we may never get out of. The United Nations has launched a new universal agenda for humanity. And those are not my words, they come right out of the core document for the agenda. The Pope traveled to New York City to address this conference and get it kicked off to bring everybody together. They call it UN 2030. And they're saying by the year 2030, which is 12 and a half years from now, that we're going to have a one world united everybody. 12 and a half years. What are we going to do then? 12 and a half years. How is your kids going to be in 12 years? Now let's hope and pray the Lord sends a move of God and the Lord holds it off until we can all get everybody saved and get out of here in the rapture. But now I'll bring you next Sunday night, Lord willing, the rest of this stuff, it'll blow your mind. It'll curl a hair on the back of your neck. The new morality is of the devil. The old morality is still right. Don't you hear it? You hear it and see it, and hear it and see it so much. You hear it on TV. You hear it. If you're not careful, you'll start thinking, "Well, maybe they are born gay. Maybe there are other religions." You'll start thinking that if you're not careful. You have to be smacked in line. That's what preaching does. It keeps you in line. May God help us. The old is better. Let's stand. Let's stand by our heads for prayer. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Our heads bowed.